I want to welcome each of you. I'm so excited to host our guest this afternoon. Hi, Dale.
Hi there, Sherry. It's a delight to be with you.
It's so good to be with you. We're just going to let everybody come in. Orna Stern says hi from Westport, Dale.
Yes, a very good friend. Hi, Orna. Isn't that lovely?
It's so nice because by inviting people to introduce themselves, we kind of make a much smaller, more intimate community.
Yes, yes.
So as we've got a lot of people signed up, so I do want to give people a few minutes to come on in.
Sure.
Don't be embarrassed to introduce yourself. You never know, your next door neighbor might be in the same Zoom as you, and you could have a little bit of tea together after and have a conversation. Peggy from La Mirada, Andy from Philly, I love, it's in the afternoon there. And St. Louis, hi Cheryl. And Ruth.
Isn't that from, great?
Yeah, it's wonderful. I'm so grateful. Oh, I forgot our Cape Town friends. We're so happy you're here. We go out of our way to make sure that we can do it at hours that you can be a part of it. So we're glad for our South Africans and our Australians and our Israelis. And then people right in my backyard, Calabasas, Sherman Oaks, Camarillo. And another Cape Townian. We're so happy our Australian, our South Africans are here. You know, we're in 14 countries. I don't know if you know that, Dale. We're in
You mentioned that. It's remarkable, and you haven't been doing this that long.
No, we've only been doing it for about 3 months. And the reason I'm giving us a few more minutes is just because we have so many people signed up. I want to make sure that everybody has a chance before we start. Hi, sure. Lynn, Brody, welcome. We're so happy that rabbis are in the room or in the house, as they say, or as my daughters would say, don't say that, Mom.
Well, they're in their house.
They're in their house, right? So we'll keep letting everybody come in. Keep introducing yourself. I love Mercer Island. Bev, what a beautiful place. I spoke there once. It was stunning. So as people are continuing to come in, I want to welcome everyone from near and far and say that we're so glad that you're spending the next hour with myself and my incredibly special guest, Dr. Dale Atkins, who will share with us not only her wisdom, but her soul. And you will soon find out that she's an extraordinary human being. We've been friends for years, and so it's truly an honor for me to host you. Just want to remind everybody a few things. We are on the Biyachad platform, which is spearheaded by American Jewish University. For those of you that are familiar, American Jewish University is unlike every other university like Harvard or Princeton, not in the sense that we don't have academic programs, but our external facing non-academic programs are even bigger than our internal programs. So you might be familiar with Camp Balanim, the Brandeis Bardeen Institute, our Wizen School, our Moss Center for Jewish Journeys. And we hope that you'll come back again and again to continue growing your soul and your Jewish wisdom. We are here to help elevate your Jewish life and to help you understand where you fit in to this world and into this moment in particular. So with that, I couldn't be more delighted that we're discussing managing your emotional well-being this morning with Dr. Dale Atkins, because I don't know about you, but I have tremendous cabin fever. And my 13-year-old of my 5 kids just said to me recently, like, I'm sick of you. And I wanted to say, and so am I sick of you. But before we get right to all the questions, because I want to just learn from you, I want to take a moment to introduce you. Our friendship goes back many years, and it goes back to not on a personal level, but also at a professional level. And I want to start by saying how much I've learned from you and how grateful I am for your mentorship as well as your friendship.
Thank you.
I love doing the Today Show with you, but you are so far more seasoned with 6-7 books under your belt, a private practice based in Connecticut, but also in New York. Dale is the go-to person when it comes to all things, whether it's Today's Show, CNN, she is the go-to psychotherapist. Over 45 years in practice, I think your wisdom has touched so many individuals personally, and now I hear people quote you all the time. Your most recent book, The Kindness Advantage, written by a social, along with you. Oh, thanks, I need it. I'm so bummed I don't have mine in hand. And you should order it immediately, because not only was it named one of the 10 best parenting books of 2018, but it by the Huffington Post is one of the most important books for teaching kindness, written by a social worker and yourself. That social worker happens to be your niece.
Yes.
And I had the delight in writing a blurb for the back. So I have a personal investment. I've read it a few times. And I just want to remind everybody, there's no greater wisdom than teaching your children how to be kind. The greatest compliment I get as a parent is when people say, not what my children have achieved or not achieved, but that they are kind human souls. And so I want to start with that. But I just want to welcome you because I know that this topic is so deep for people and so important. So thank you, Dale, for being here.
Thank you, Sherry, for having me and for that very generous introduction. And it's wonderful to see you. We've known each other for so long, but we haven't seen each other recently. And via screen is good. You know, it's good enough right now, right?
Yeah, and I like that it's good enough, right? Yeah. I keep telling people good enough is a really important place to be.
Yes,
so let's start by using people are feeling unstable, uncertain. And I think, like myself, most of us thought, if I could do this for a limited period of time, I would be okay. But it seems to have an ambiguity and an uncertainty about when this is going to be all over. Tell me, what do you see in your practice and in your speaking appearances about how people are feeling and why this has become so problematic with our personal anxieties?
I think because it is a time of uncertainty and it is a time of changing information. And it is a time of making plans and then having to alter them. It's also a time, I mean, just if you look at the people who are on this call and where they come from, each of them is living in a state or a country with a different orientation as to what they can, should, would feel comfortable doing. And, you know, some people are allowed to do certain things and some people are encouraged to do other things. And everybody has to kind of make their own decisions based on what's right for them, what's right for their family. And I think that living with uncertainty is usually very challenging for most people. Living in a time when you say, you know, if you tell me I'm going to be kind of in my house with my loved ones for a month, okay, I'll figure it out. Or maybe 3 months, I'll figure it out. But let me know so I can plan and I can adapt and I know what I'm looking forward to. If you keep changing the goalposts, or if you say, well, this is, we're definitely giving you this information and then it changes, or, well, it seems like that's the information, but now it's someone else told me this, which is, by the way, one of the reasons so many people are addicted to the news, because they're trying to get information that is not necessarily factual from different sources, and there is this kind of addiction quality which raises the anxiety. So I think that part of the reason is that there isn't a specific end point and there isn't a specific rule book or playbook. So that's one issue. The other issue is that people are together or very much alone. So we have people who are living on their own and maybe experiencing extreme loneliness. It doesn't mean that if you're living with other people, you're not lonely, which for those people can be even worse because they're unaware that they could be lonely living with these people whom they care about. But the people who are living alone, who had a life outside of their home and maybe chose to live alone and like to live alone, but now they're very lonely because they don't have what they had in order to give them confidence and connection and a feeling of meaning and importance in their life and purpose. So, you know, maybe their volunteer job is no longer available, or the people that they're used to seeing are no longer available, or the barista down the block when they go to get their morning coffee. These are the things that these routines and these, their comfort zones for us in our normal life, and they're not there. So I think that the question as far as why the anxiety and why is everybody feeling this way, people are feeling different amounts of anxiety. People who are normally a bit anxious often are much more anxious. And I think what's important is that each of us be able to keep a finger on our pulse, recognize what is being triggered, what feeling is being triggered, how are we doing emotionally, and then be able to put into play ways to deal with that. People may be grieving.
God, you just said so much that I want to unpack and I want to break it down for a second because there was so much in there. The first is the no playbook.
Yes.
Right? and that there's different rules for everyone. Do you think it's harder for people that one person does X and another person does Y, and that's affecting the loneliness because you don't even know who to trust or who's in line with your values? Is that exacerbating the problem? Do you think it would be better if we were all under one rule book?
I think it would be helpful if there was one reliable source of information that we could all say, okay, this is kind of what seems to be going on. And then we could make our own decisions based on information that we could really trust. And I think we might have had that a little bit earlier on, not early on, kind of March, April, with regular updates about where we are health-wise and research-wise. But this seems to be very uncharted territory. Not uncharted territory in there weren't other viruses, virulent viruses, but uncharted territory for this particular virus in the way it seems to be attacking the whole world. So I think, yes, that would be helpful. I think that without getting political, I think it's very important to have leaders to whom you can look, who will be giving examples of what is the behavior that is being encouraged by the experts. And I think for many people, that's just not happening. So it raises anxiety. What should I do? What shouldn't I do? Which is not to say that if someone says, this is what we can do, but you don't have to, but you're not in that group because perhaps you have an underlying condition or you're in an age group that is more at risk, you still make decisions based on what's good for you. To your specific question, Cherry, would it make you more lonely? It would make you more unsettled. It would make you more uncomfortable with feeling secure. And that may contribute to the feelings of loneliness. And that may contribute to the feelings of loss and the feelings of mourning. So that it's very subtle and it's kind of a mosaic. And I don't think anyone is feeling just one feeling all the time. And then, okay, well, I used to be anxious, but now I'm doing okay. I think that most people express to me anyway, and what I'm reading in the research, that there's this low level, and I put my hands here just because, this low level of worry. And sometimes it really gets loud, and sometimes it's a little more muted. Watching the news nonstop, having it on in the background, feeling that you have to touch base and find out what the news is, increases that anxiety, because what happens is there's a lot of dopamine that's released with kind of, I have to get the latest news, and I have to know, and we get more anxious. So it's very important in this time to be able to say, how do I feel when I watch the news? How do I feel after I watch the news? Which news sources are better for me? Mm-hmm. I know many people are turning off the news and reading the news from different sources, and they feel much better. They don't watch it before they go to bed for good reason, and try to do some sleep ritual to try and help deal with the anxiety on a regular basis, the uncertainty, the anxiety, the crowdedness, those kinds of things.
Well, I love this idea that asking yourself throughout the day, like, how am I feeling prior to this and after this, right? Whether it's the television news or even certain people we're with, because you talk to certain people on the phone and afterwards you're like, the world is coming to an end. And then you talk to other people and you're like, okay, I can make it through another day.
Right.
I also want to push you a little bit on this loneliness, because I think what I see as a rabbi is people that would never describe themselves as lonely, and it would even seem something like a negative branding, are now feeling it but don't know how to name it. And I think loneliness is truly misunderstood. We have the highest epidemics of loneliness in the world for young people right now. But can you go a little deeper into why we feel a little more lonely, even if we have a packed house of human beings, or even if we have lots of contact? What is that that's exacerbating that?
What exacerbates it is not being heard and being able to feel comfortable with the feelings that you have. I'm often told by people that, you know, they will maybe say to someone, I'm really feeling anxious. Well, you know, everybody is. Just get over it. You'll get through it. It's okay. And yes, everyone is. And it's very helpful to know that we're not alone and that we are all connected. But at the moment that I want to express the suffering that I'm feeling, I need it to be validated. For some people, they don't have that kind of relationship or they're afraid of saying something to someone and they'll say, oh, I don't want to bring them down, or I don't know about the response they're going to give me, so I'll keep it to myself. And that loneliness may be an experience that they're having that maybe they really wish they could be with somebody who would have been a comfort for them had that person been there. Perhaps a mother who passed away, perhaps a friend who lives very far away, and they just can't make that connection. I find it extremely useful to encourage people to engage with the person, even if they're not here, and feel their warmth, feel their embrace, feel what they would say. I will share with you that I have my father with me all the time. And when I feel a little bit uneasy, or if I feel frightened, or if I feel unsure, I always sit back and I say, Dad, what do you think? And I engage him. It's interesting because I just feel his presence and I feel what he might say or not say, just to be close to me. And I feel that energetically. I encourage people to do rituals that might help them feel more grounded, to go through photographs of times when they really felt connected and went to a place that was really lovely when they weren't lonely. And I also encourage people to, when they touch base with people, when they call them or when they're doing what we're doing and talking on Zoom, instead of saying how you're doing and get through the whole, you know, what do you think about this and what do you think about that, connect. And connect in a way that gives them a hug. And the way I call it, a conversational hug. Mm-hmm. So that I would want to tell someone that I was thinking about them and the time that we were together and we took a trip, and that I learned something from them because I watched them deal with someone who was very aggressive, and they dealt with them in a really kind way, in a really gentle way, in a patient way. And I share that memory with this person. That person who may have been lonely or wondering, you know, my goodness, what's going on next? I'm so alone, is then having this rekindling of a feeling inside when they were appreciated, when something they did, which they may not have even known, had an impact on someone else who they cared about. I also encourage children in particular, but also adult children, to share with their parents, who they may not be seeing because of COVID isolation, what they learned from them, what they admire about them, why they think they're role models for them. And I think that when we hear from other people what they're grateful for about knowing us, what they've learned from us, this is the ultimate kindness, because you validate that that person has meant something to you and that their life is worthwhile. When we're lonely, we often feel that we are forgotten and that maybe our life wasn't worth much. But when we realize from another person that we made a difference, that our life has meaning, that we have a purpose, we feel much more connected to the world. And so a conversational hug is a way to engage in a very deep and meaningful level with someone and let them know they're important.
I love that. There's so much you say that I'm just like so moved by. Today's my mother, would have been my mother's 76th birthday. She died 10 years ago. And I always say,
when she died.
I do too. I always say, WWBD, what would Barbara do? Uh-huh. But I think what you're touching upon is really using memory in this moment, not the memory of this moment, but past memories, to really amplify the good feelings that are associated with them and allow them to propel you into the future, right? Because I think a lot of the loneliness and loss, it's not just the loss of people that aren't here, but the loss of not the graduation I expected, yes. The trip I was planning, the cruise, yes. I was going on, the grandchild I was gonna hold, the bris I was gonna attend. I mean, the list goes on and on. And what you're saying is, you know, it's really easy to get on the phone or get on the Zoom with someone and say, like, how are you doing? How are you managing? But to really go that extra step and to connect deeply, and by giving them that conversational hug, to really say, here's what I want to tell you.
I think it's very important, Sherry. And the multiple losses are often more, they're more prominent certain times than others. And so again, when you keep your finger on your pulse, it's not that you just say, well, you know, somebody else has it worse than I. Yes, someone probably always has it worse than I. But at this moment, I need to pay attention to how I'm feeling. And it's okay not to feel okay. And it's okay to be able to sit with that and recognize what you need. Because if we don't do that, the feeling will still be there and it will probably come up as anxiety or a lot of fear, depression. And when you talked about isolation, one of the things, and loneliness, one of the things we see is an increase in depression. And we were seeing this before COVID. And right now, it's really important that people feel connected. One of the ways we get through difficult times, challenging times, and you know, how quickly can we recover? Not bounce back, because you're never going to be, there's no going back, we're going forward. How do we recover? How quickly do we recover and be able to move forward, move through it? I like to say that whatever's happening now is part of our weave. It's going to be part of our fabric. So how do we integrate it? And how does this COVID period transform us with the connections we're making, with the way we're thinking, with what we're doing? You know, I always do it this way and this is the way I'm going to do it. Well, right now that doesn't work. So are you going to hang on to an old way of thinking and doing, or are you going to be open to learning? You started our talk together with, you know, learning. What do I need to learn about myself and the other people I'm living with that will help me get through this in a kind, generous way, compassionate way to myself and to them? How can I really support myself and the people I'm living with, or the people who I'm not living with but who I'm concerned about? What do they need? This is the most incredibly challenging time, and it's the most perfect time, because we have so few distractions, to be able to really connect with the people that we're with. Who are they? And what do they need? And what do they mean to us? And what do we love about them? And what could we share about what we love about them with them? And how can we not jump at them because everybody's on edge? How can we try and nurture ourselves and be compassionate for ourselves, take care of ourselves, particularly if we're taking care of everybody else?
Right. That intention is so profound. And I'm listening to it and I'm thinking, of course, how do I serve my children? How do I acknowledge how much this obstacle is giving me an opportunity to love them more and to serve them? But in the moment with four teenagers, sometimes I want to wring their neck.
So, and yes.
And what do you say in that moment when you're really feeling sort of the darkness and the difficulty? Because I love this idea of giving yourself a permission slip, right? You said, I have permission to feel lonely. I have permission to get help. I have permission to feel anxious. But what do you do in that moment to switch off that voice and turn on the one that says, this is an opportunity for growth. This is an opportunity for me to take this moment and learn from it.
That part of it comes later, because when you're right in the thick of the fire, you're not really thinking about the after fire. You're thinking about how am I going to get out of here? So they are paired, but they're not simultaneous. And if we don't do the first part, we're not going to get to the second part. The first thing we do is to breathe. Our bodies need to be calm.
I think everybody should take a breath. Just as we're sitting here, I want to like...
Well, why don't we? Why don't we just all take a breath?
Let everybody just take a breath.
So the breath is something that is very important. And I advise everybody to be able to get through this by breathing the way you normally breathe. And just be aware that if you're able to, the exhalation, if you can give that exhalation an extra second or two, that's where the relaxation happens. So if you can just breathe through your nose, and if you can't breathe through your nose, breathe through your mouth, and feel the air come in, and just notice your body, just notice how it feels when you take a breath, and then a gently exhale. And just feel the exhalation. And take another breath and just breathe in gently and calmly. Feel the air coming in through your nostrils. Maybe you feel your belly push out a little bit with the inhalation. And then you just relax as you exhale. And that exhalation could be a moment or two longer.
I literally want to take, I want to take you in my purse every day.
You can. You in. It's better than me. You have your breath. Your breath is with you all the time. It's the most mobile, the most accessible, and we have it all the time. You don't need a cushion to sit on. You don't have to go to the Himalayas. All you need to do is pause and breathe. And when we do that, we start to relax our body. Once we relax our body, then we can think about relaxing our mind. The mind is running around in 1,000 places. The mind may be anxious or worried or sad or whatever it is. It's okay. But first, let's just be in touch with the body and then understand that however you feel is how you feel. Don't judge it. It just is.
Which is so hard because we're constantly in the state of comparison with other people. Like, she looks like she's managing better. Her kids are look like they're doing better. You look on social media and like their family's playing puzzles every night. I can barely get my kids to dinner. And if that, I'm lucky, right? So there's this real sort of compare and despair and feeling like, why am I not doing this as well as everybody else? And I think what you're saying is you've got to own where you're at.
It's right? More than own. It's be okay with where you're at.
Oh, that's and accept.
Okay. I think it's really about acceptance. The book that we wrote, the first of these 10 fundamentals is acceptance. And it's accepting yourself and accepting where you are and accepting the situation. And you don't have to like it, you just accept where it is. And then you can adapt. Because it's all about adaptation. We're adapting as best we can. Some days we'll adapt better than other days. And what's important is to be able to recognize how you can pivot. And, you know, for a family that does puzzles every night, fantastic. Isn't that wonderful? May not be my family. So what's going to work for my family? I will share with you that I was speaking to a family just yesterday. And I said, how would you all feel? It was a family therapy session. If you just held hands when you're at your next meal and just took a breath. And each one of them said they would like that. And each one of them thought the other would think it was kind of puny. And they thought, ugh, we're not going to do that. But they all wanted to do it. I think we start small, start simple, and we see what works for us. But to specifically answer your question, when we take the breath, then we can say, how do we feel? Mm-hmm. If you're willing to look at what that feeling is and just feel it, without judging it and saying, oh, you shouldn't feel that way, or you don't, what do you mean? You have all these things. Why are you you're sick. You don't have the right to feel that way. There is no judgment. There is no criticism. There is just what is a feeling. We are human beings.
We are human. We feel disappointment and sadness.
Yes, we do.
And
we can feel it. We can feel disappointment. We can feel sadness. We can also feel joy. We can also see. You're more likely, by the way, to see what the silver linings are and to see what you can be so grateful for if you acknowledge the balance, the range, the incredible range of feelings that we all have. And we'll also be more likely to be accepting of those in our partners, in our children. And we'll say, yep, you have every right to feel that way. You really are disappointed. And, you know, you really did want to go to your prom. Or, yeah, it's not the same. It's not the same that you expected. But what can we do about it? How can we make it great? Making that shift is what you were talking about before, which is how is this going to be transformative? Where's the opportunity? But unless we acknowledge what is, we then can't worry. We can't think about how we can transform it. But we have to be in this moment. In this moment is the only moment where we can really figure out how we feel.
You are so wise. And people have already texted in, like, this is just excellent because your wisdom takes us to that place of really giving ourselves permission to be in this moment, to accept this moment, because it's going to transform us to be different with others and the people we love. Like, we don't want to kill our teenagers. So I just want to remind everybody we're with Biyaha Together, Spirited by American Jewish University, for those of you that just came in, although most of you have been here since the beginning. I also want to begin to open it up for questions because I know a lot of people have questions for you, Dale.
Sure.
And I also want to talk a little bit about the kindness advantage because I think
thank you.
That what you're really talking a lot about too is not just acceptance, but also self-love and kindness to yourself. So tell me about that.
Well, kindness to yourself, and I think if people want to learn more about that, it would be wonderful. You know, chesed is all about kindness, right? But it's more than kindness. It's really loving kindness. Hmm. It's loving kindness.
You know, you're so Jewish. That is very Jewish.
How are we present, and how do we connect with either a person, a task, an act? When we do an act of kindness, what's behind it? And it's really trying to go to what's behind that act of kindness. So when we're doing an act of kindness for ourselves, I would ask people, if they want to learn more about this, to look at the work of Sharon Salzberg in the world of mm-hmm. loving kindness and self-compassion, to look at the work of Kristen Neff, Tara Brock. There are so many people who are studying this, the neuroscience of kindness and self-kindness with Richie Davidson. We know what we know anecdotally. Now we know it because we have functional MRIs and we see how the brain changes when we are kind to ourselves and kind to others. And when we do, for instance, a loving kindness meditation or loving kindness prayer, we are actually allowing ourselves to feel what it's like if we say something, and this is really almost directly from Sharon Salzberg, may I be safe? May I be healthy? May I be happy? May I be at ease? And we feel that. And then we say that as we envision a partner or a friend or a child or the person, a stranger. So that we are connecting ourselves with ourselves and with others. With self-compassion, in order to have compassion for others, it's so much easier and better, I think, if you have compassion for yourself, because you're forgiving and you recognize your humanity. So what is it? It's really understanding that you're really struggling now. It's okay that you want to kill your kids. You're not going to, God, please.
No.
But it's okay to have the feeling. And what is that feeling? I'm so exhausted. Could everybody just leave me alone? I just want to be in my own spot. I want to have my own little place where nobody's going to come in and mess anything up or move it around. I want to just have quiet, or I want to listen to my own music, or I just want to work on my plants, whatever it is. I need a moment, but I'm not getting a moment. And so, this is really hard. So you recognize that mm-hmm. without the voice of, oh, come on, come on, come on.
Then, well, I think that's what a lot of people, what I'm hearing is like, I need that moment. I go take a half hour to myself, but then I feel guilty, right? So I should have, I could have, my kids are feeling abandoned. My mother's feeling abandoned. I hear it a lot from people. Like, I could have used that half hour to go social distance from my parents or bring them food. Why didn't I do that? There's a lot of the beating the self up.
It's the self-critical voice. So when we do this over time, the self-critical voice actually changes. It becomes more tame and becomes more of a self-loving voice. And it takes practice, but it happens, because basically what you'll say is, you know what? I am suffering. Suffering is actually a part of life. And God, everybody else is suffering. Look how many people are feeling this way. So you feel connected and not alone. And then the next piece that we can say to ourselves is, I need to be kind to myself. I'm going to put my hand on my heart, or maybe on my belly, and I'm just going to hold myself for a minute and say, not that critical chatter, and say what a loving person, in my case, luckily, my dad, my mom, would have said to me. Maybe a teacher or a coach or a rabbi, someone you knew. Or maybe it's you in how you talk to your child who's frightened. And maybe you say, oh, come here, sweetie, let me hug you and just feel that I'm with you. It'll be okay.
Well, and you're tapping.
Really, and I'm holding my heart because we're talking heart to heart. And I'm getting goosebumps because when I say that to myself, I will say, come on, Dale, you can do this. Mm-hmm. Or you know what? This is really, you just need to rest a moment. And then I might say, I think I need to play with the dog, or I think I want to take a walk, or I think, but I've recognized it. And that chatter critical voice is not invited here. This is like a no critical voice zone. This is the warm, enveloping, supportive, loving voice zone. The more you practice that, and the more you say to yourself, is that critical voice really helpful to me? I mean, look, a little bit of guilt is kind of helpful because otherwise we probably wouldn't do a lot of the things that we're obliged to do.
Right. But
too much, you're not motivated to do it again if you're constantly beating yourself up. If you are encouraged, and this is what the whole kindness advantage is about, how can we nurture what's in us? How can we nurture this kindness, this resilience, this compassion? We all have it. We are born with it. We just need to nurture it, but practice. So when we do these kind of self-compassion exercises every day, when we breathe intentionally every day, multiple times a day, just for a few moments, multiple times a day, we are also setting an example to our children. Say, you know what? I'm going to take a breath. You want to join me?
And not just to our children, but to our parents. I mean, you're really tapping into Jewish tradition. Loving kindness is chesed.
Yes.
And what you're talking about is really that deep level of chesed that the Hasidim used to really focus on. It's like, how do we tap into that? This space and time is sacred for me to be kind to myself and then extend that to others so that I can serve God and serve the world. I mean, it's very, very Jewish, but also very profoundly Jewish, right?
Sherry, you mentioned with parents. I find so many people feel this, they're worried about their parents and there's an obligation. And yet sometimes there isn't the gentle, there isn't the tenderness at this moment in time during COVID. And I think when we do this, I know when we do this and take care of ourselves, we will be more open. And we can even say to ourselves, instead of a half an hour conversation, I'm gonna have a 10 minute conversation. I'm gonna have a 10 minute conversation and I'm just going to listen. And I'm going to try and find two or three encouraging things to say that will maybe make this conversation go a little differently. You know,
I got to interrupt you because I was looking at one. I was not looking at the Q&A, and there's so many questions that came in.
Okay, I'll zip it and let's hear them.
There are no particular order, but I really, your wisdom is so important. And I know a lot of people have been talking about, like, there's no external validation helping lift you up. So everything has to come from within. And they're getting tired of that self-talk. Mm. What do you do in that situation? Because you're not getting the attaboys and the attagirls. And I can tell you what we've done on my teams, but I'd love to hear what you recommend.
Well, please tell us what you've done on your teams.
Well,
lot of it is probably what we need to know.
Well, I'm just saying that each time my team meets, which is twice a week on one team and once a week on another, we start with attagirls and attaboys because I just want them to hear how much each other is making a difference and appreciating one another. And at first it felt a little forced, you know, it's like, didn't we do this 2 days ago? But now you can really see how much it's transforming the way that people need some external validation just to be valued and recognized.
I agree with you. And I think what's important is that we not look at that as something that means we're weak. It means we're connected. And really, I mean, if you look at the studies that are done in businesses, the people who really do well and who want and are very loyal to their companies and who will try to recruit friends to work in the same companies are people who feel they're noticed and they're valued and they are encouraged. So in a family, for instance, why don't we share on a regular basis what we're grateful for about the people in our family? It can be and on a regular basis, and that every single person, it's kind of like highlight of the week, but it's highlight of every day. You know, you start looking through a lens, we call it the lens of kindness. When you look through the lens of gratitude, there's enormous research on the value of writing down what you're grateful for before you go to bed. The research act is very interesting because what it does is it highlights how we are able to then look at other things in our lives that we're grateful for, not just what we're grateful for tonight or today, but anything and everything.
Well, so much what you're saying is see the good, and it's things that we know, but it's easy to forget when it feels that the external environment is so oppressive. Let me bring up another question, just because I want to make sure we answer some of these, which is so beautiful. You know, struggling with opposing feelings, anger and empathy, especially towards others. How is that a reflection of myself, and how much is that really a reflection of what's going on in society? You know, we saw a woman cough on another woman at a bagel store recently, and it's like, you had empathy, as inappropriate it was, you could understand that feeling of just being so angry and so over everything, right? And I think we're challenged by that.
We are challenged by it. Amanda's my co-author, wrote a whole section about, you know, how do you deal with bullying and how do you deal with inappropriate behavior and how do you try to understand the bully? And I think that we have to also, how do we understand the person who is, you know, wrathful within ourselves, and how can we, and what is it? What can we tap into that allows us to understand and also to recognize and again not judge? Where's this anger coming from? We can be angry and we can be empathic. We are human beings. We are emotional. We are social beings. Once you interact with another person, you're going to be smoothed, you know, you're going to be weakly comforted, or you're going to be prickly. And that's what's going to happen all the time. So being aware of why, what's going on in me that I'm having this emotional response, what do I think it's from? Breathe and just sit with it. It will reveal itself. But to say, I shouldn't be angry, or I should have more empathy, we can build empathy. We can reduce the negative effects of anger. We don't want to reduce anger. Anger is very often what gets us motivated to change our society. If people weren't angry, we wouldn't be seeing what we're seeing. So anger is not the problem. What our relationship is to our anger and the way it is expressed or not expressed. A lot of people swallow their anger and all kinds of body malfunctions are a result. The same with all kinds of emotions, but you want to be able to find outlets to appropriately express how you feel. And I think that it takes practice, because very few of us were raised in environments with really great models of how to express what are referred to as negative emotions. Many of us would just stop that. Don't do that. You're not allowed to do that. It's not whatever. Right. But it wasn't welcome. And I think what we need to do is just put the welcome mat out and figure it out if you're going to be kind to yourself in the process.
So and I'm gonna limit you for a few minutes just because some of these questions
are.
No. I want to, you know, like Shiva, at the beginning when there's a death, everybody comes around, and 30 days into it, like Shloshim, it's sort of quiet. A lot of people have been talking about, you know, in the beginning, everyone reached out, and now they're alone and isolated. Friends don't call. How do you, if you want to reach out and you know you need the connection, how do you reach out to people without bothering them, without being like, we're past 30 days, I still need those connections? What do you say? Absolutely. What do you advise?
You know, you mentioned something before, Sherry, and you said, you know, some people you call them up and it's like, oh my God, they're really not good for me. I think it's important to figure out who you're reaching out to. And I think the honesty is important. Sometimes people are getting very busy and they forget that particularly people who are living alone need a touch, right? They need a touch. And if you're the person who needs it, I think you can write a letter. You can, I prefer not text, but you can call and you can say, you know, I just want you to know that I'd love to talk. What would be comfortable for you? Would you, you know, are you up for a check-in every week for just a little while? And, you know, would that be okay? And I think that to ask for what we need when we recognize what our needs are is a useful thing to do. There are certain people who you may want to have that touch with for a specific issue. Like maybe you want to talk to somebody about some work concerns, but somebody else you want to talk to about being connected with the family. Be careful about who you reach out to, because you really don't want to get the door slammed in your face. And, you know, the thought of somebody having a weekly conversation may be great for someone, but someone else should be free to say, I don't know that I can do it every week, but I sure would like to do it every other week. And, you know, that would be really lovely. Or maybe we should email more, and then we can talk about one thing. I also think what's important is for people to become a part of, instead of apart from, book groups, temple services,
community.
You know, community.
Even digital community.
Especially, well, it's all we have right now. So every community is digital, even if you see familiar faces from your temple, it's still digital. But at the end of the temple service, as our temple is doing, everybody hangs around a little bit and says one thing they're grateful for about the week. Well, it's quite remarkable. I've been a member of my synagogue for 14 years, and I'm finding out things about people through this screen, everybody sitting in their living rooms or their dining rooms or their kitchens, and people are sharing that which I would have not known. So someone said, my daughter finished her chemo. Well, I didn't know that her daughter was ill. Someone else mentioned, my husband just got back from the hospital. There is opportunity to connect, and you don't have to be part of anything other than open to what
I just what love other people want. I love that you share that, because when this started, I started taking a yoga class in Baltimore, and from the very beginning the teacher goes on early and she stays on late, and she's built a community of people I've never met, and we know each other's lives, and every Tuesday and Thursday morning we're there. And so I now, on Biyachat Together, all of our classes, we ask our teachers to come early and to stay late, and let there be a moment of togetherness, like you were sort of hanging out after class, but you're doing it digitally. So we're completely out of time. I mean, completely out of time. But I want to say that there's been a number of other questions that I know that you would be open to answering. So I want to encourage people to go to drdaleatkins.com or The Kindness Advantage, both of your websites where you can solicit questions. There's great ones about in leadership, how exposed should you share your own anxiety when you're supposed to be the person of calm? What are you supposed to do with, you know, dealing with not feeling cared about? There's so many good questions here. And what I know about Dr. Dale Atkins is that her wisdom is life wisdom. There are things that you've said to me 20 years ago that resonate for me today, whether it was in front of the camera or behind the camera. And I know that that is transformative for people. So before
I give my email,
please.
Okay. It's dale@drdaleatkins.com. So it's dale@drdaleatkins.com.
I just want to say, not many people do you know that's like, oh, let me just give you dale@drdaleatkins.com. You know, on when we have over 350 people registered, but that's Dale. So I want to remind everybody, first of all, that I hope you'll keep tuning in to Biyachad Together, that I think this morning and this afternoon, wherever you are, maybe even this evening, that it's been an extraordinary morning of figuring out how to manage that cabin fever, but also all those emotions that are so challenging for us. Biyachad Together every day has a free offering, and I hope you'll come back again and again and again. I hope that you'll come here for Jewish wisdom, from technology to business to living well to dealing with this moment to Jewish history. I hope that you'll also sign up for classes in the month of July and in August. We have lots of wonderful offerings. You can take one class, you can take two classes, you can take four classes. We are so glad you're here. We want to make this a small community. Dr. Dale Atkins.
Thank you.
Truly honored. Can't wait to read Kindness Advantage again. As you know, I give it to all my friends. To everybody.
Enjoy it.
I do. To everyone, I wish you to be well and to stay well and to join us again on Biyachad Together. Thank you.
Take care. Bye.